Clipper Audio presents an unabridged recording of Vorpal Blade by John Ringo. This unabridged recording is narrated by L.J. Ganser and directed by Robert Pear. This book is copyrighted 2007 by John Ringo and Travis S. Taylor. This recording is copyrighted 2009 by Recorded Books. Sci-Fi Audio is an imprint dedicated exclusively to science fiction and fantasy titles on CD, from classics to bestsellers, cult hits to critically acclaimed award winners. The former USSN Nebraska has been jerry-rigged using alien technology and good old American know-how into a warp ship ready to visit strange new worlds. But as everyone knows, the people who really are going to bear the brunt of the exploratory mission are the poor guys in security. And now, Vorpal Blade.
Chapter 1. A plate of XXXX at Vaishua at 7 Mescue Club Q with a side of muons, please. You think I should hit the order again? Bill said, looking over at the kitchen. Service in Adar restaurants was proverbially slow, but this was ridiculous. He and Sal had sent in their orders over 30 minutes ago, and still they didn't even have their drinks. Lieutenant Commander William Doc Weaver, RN, PhD, wasn't really happy about the lunch anyway. He'd known Sal Weinstein back when they both worked for Columbia Defense, so when Sal called and asked if he was doing anything for lunch, he thought it was just a social call. He should have guessed that Sal, whom he hadn't spoken to in 2 years, wasn't going to drive down to Norfolk to chat. "Won't work," Sal said, shrugging. "But go ahead if it makes you happy. Now, about the server." Bill flipped open the menu and hit the entry for glangi with extra malayagul sauce. The thing didn't even flash. He'd already ordered with this menu. One menu, one order. No tiki, no laundry. "It's a damned Microsoft Vavala server with some code thrown on top," Bill replied, hitting the entry again. The restaurant wasn't particularly crowded, and now he knew why. Some of the Adar had started to catch on that humans didn't take 4 hours for lunch. Clearly, the family unit running this place were right out of the glass. "We've got top Adar working on it," Sal argued. "Top Adar." "You've got Faz Glim and Dulaol," Bill said, not looking up, "who are the only Adar I've ever met who fall into the description of credit whores. And neither one of them knows diddly mock about server tech. Faz Glim's a natural processes philo, and Dulaol is a micro-actions philo. So you're telling me you've got the best server on the market because you happen to have a tame biologist and quantum physicist who are willing to sign off on it. It's an MS-Vav, which is one of the buggiest servers in the world, with code from Cole Gomo programming thrown on top. And that makes it buggier. Come on, Sal, don't try to snow me. I know Adar tech. I work with it every damned day." The problem was, since the opening of the looking glasses, the whole world, and especially Wall Street, had gone nuts over Adar. Adar tech was light years ahead of human, but it wasn't magic. And a lot of stuff that was sold as being Adar technology was anything but. The Adar had been a philosophical race when they encountered humans, which meant they were about as resistant to marketing as Native Americans to disease. So more and more of them were emigrating to Earth where everything was prettier. And by and large, they could command immense salaries because if a company had an Adar, even if the male, female, or transfer neuter was the training equivalent of a janitor, they could say they had an Adar working on their technology. Bill had fallen for that scam exactly once. An Adar tech shampoo substitute. Basically, it was a comb you were supposed to use in the shower to wash your hair. Guaranteed to do miraculous things for your entire head region. He was still trying to grow the hair back. He had to admit that there was some great stuff out there that was derived from real Adar technology. Forget brushing your teeth. All you had to do was pop a nano brush capsule, crunch it in your teeth, and not only did your teeth turn lily white, but you didn't have to worry about halitosis for 12 hours. Then there was the entire electronic tech revolution. Wait, got a call, Sal said, holding up his hand to the back of his head. Yeah, Joe, Sal. That's great, man. Implants, though. Jeez. Back when they were the killer app, Doc had thought BlackBerry was a pain in the ass. The only way you could tell the difference between a raving street guy and a raving corporate attorney was the quality of clothing and that one had a flashing blue thing in his ear. But since implants had hit the market, people really did hear voices. Now you couldn't tell the difference at all. Of course, he was wearing a Varenthal earpiece, which gave him pretty much the same look as an implant wearer, but you could at least see the damned earring. He hit the menu again and was amazed to see an Adar exit the door to the restaurant's kitchens, bearing a massive platter. That was the other thing about Adar cooking. The Adar approached their two daily meals with religious reverence. The most undertrained, neuter home cook had more passion for cuisine than a cordon bleu chef. Each meal had to be both satisfying and a work of art. They were worse than the Japanese about it. So while Bill would have been perfectly satisfied with a platter of glangi noodles, what he got instead was a half a dozen dishes, condiments, sides, little crunchy things. None of it was particularly identifiable. He'd been to dinners at the White House that were less elaborate. Methmar, Weaver said, nodding to the trans-newt waiter. The transfer neuters were only semi-sentient and did most of the mundane tasks of the Adar. Far smaller than the males, much less the females, the trans-newt was about 6 feet tall, with mottled brown skin, and three eyes set over a wide, flat face that was mostly a mouth with wide, grinding molars. Clashing with the standard Adar look, though, was its clothes. The Adar, when Weaver first met them, tended to wear something not much more complex than a loincloth. However, they had never dealt with marketing departments. While Adar tech had become the rage on Earth, human styles and fads had hit the Adar like hard liquor at a redneck party. The Adar was wearing an electric purple skirt and a blouse that was basically transparent. Under it was a tank top of electric pink. It was sporting huge rhinestone-encrusted sunglasses with giant wings on either side that made it look like an Elvis Valkyrie. It was also wearing an iPod. Given that it was assuredly implanted and the iPod was at best superfluous, it had to be a fashion device.
Welcome, welcome, welcome,
the trans-newt squeaked, a terribly high falsetto from something 6 feet tall and weighing in at damned near 300 pounds.
Worship and joy, taking care of business, nothing but hound dog.
So, it meant to be an Elvis Valkyrie. Thanks, Bill said, as the being shimmied back to the kitchen. He sighed and picked up his tongs, scooping up some of the noodles. Bill Weaver had been a peaceful little scientist working for Columbia Defense, coming up with solutions to problems U.S. National Defense didn't even realize it had, when he got dragged over to the White House one rainy Saturday night to explain quantum physics to the National Security Council. A physics experiment gone awry had not only created a massive, on the order of 60 kilotons, explosion at the University of Central Florida, but it had left a strange anomaly behind. He'd just happened to be the nearest physicist the Secretary of Defense could lay his hand on, who had a top-secret clearance. Subsequent to that, he'd been blown up, ripped into other dimensions, killed, he was pretty sure, resurrected, he was more sure, and generally had a blast stopping an alien invasion. The anomaly had been a boson generator, a black sphere they still didn't have a theoretical handle on, that generated Higgs bosons at a phenomenal rate. What was worse, or better, take your pick, is that the bosons turned out to have the ability to link to other bosons and open up portals to, well, just about anywhere. Instantaneous transportation, even to other planets. The portals created mirror-like openings that had been christened looking glasses. They went some strange places, that was for sure. The kicker was that some of those planets had sentient beings that were interested in taking over the Earth. Called the Dreen, The species reproduced via a mat of fungus that was programmed to produce various other creatures, like big, howling dog demons that ate people, humanity's first contact with the Dreen, and all the way up to giant spider things the size of mountains. Presumably, there was some sentient control behind the Dreen, but Bill had never seen it. All he'd seen was rhino tanks and centipedes and howlers. Lots of howlers. The very name Dreen was an Adar rendition of the howl. Dreen! Neither humans nor the Adar had any idea what the species called itself, and didn't really care. All they cared about was avoiding them, or, if necessary, or possible, wiping them out to the last fungoid monstrosity. The upside to the gates were the Adar. They had encountered the Dreen when they'd first started creating their own glasses, had had similar problems, and had figured out how to close a glass. Basically, all it needed was a big enough explosion. Big. World-killing. Since there was no way to set it off in the middle of a transfer, the movement was as close to instantaneous as instruments could detect, you had to choose which world to set it off on. The Adar hadn't wanted to risk it, but when the Dreen were swarming through multiple portals, the humans, specifically the President of the United States, had been willing to try anything. Weaver, with the support of a short division of mech infantry and a SEAL team, had managed to stick the explosive device on the far side of a portal in Kentucky. That was the second time he was pretty sure he'd died. But he'd been spit back out after a strange conversation with an entity, or entities, that might be God. Shortly after they'd stopped the invasion, the Adar had given him another strange device. On first tests, it had appeared to be the world's most powerful nuclear hand grenade. Any electrical power sent to it, so much as a spark of static, and, well, there was a boom. A really big boom. There should have been an earth-shattering kaboom boom. Putting three-phase on it had, in fact, erased a solar system. The Adar didn't know what it was supposed to do, but Weaver had basically guessed that it was, in fact, some sort of faster-than-light drive. It took nearly a year of tinkering, and two more planets, to figure out that it was, in fact, such a drive. It had taken another year to create the first prototype starship. By then, Weaver had switched sides in the ongoing sales war, leaving the Beltway and taking a direct commission in the Navy, which was the lead service in developing the world's first spaceship. He'd pointed out, even before switching sides, that the Navy just made more sense. The President wanted a presence off-world as fast as possible. They'd picked up enough intel in the brief war to know that the Dreen had some sort of FTL as well. Finding out where the Dreen were, whether they were headed to Earth through normal space, was a high priority. The only way to make a spaceship fast was to convert something. The obvious choice had been one of the many ballistic missile submarines that were being decommissioned. So Weaver, while continuing to consult on engineering issues, was now the astrogation officer of the Naval Construction Contract 4144. Despite a couple of shakedown cruises around the solar system, the top-secret boat had yet to be named. The 4144 had all the beauty and problems of any prototype. Most of the equipment was human, much of it original to the former SSBN Nebraska. Other bits were Adar or human Adar manufacture. The fact that it worked at all was amazing. In 2 days, the still unnamed boat was going to be blasting off for points unknown. Well, actually, all the points were known. Bill had created the initial survey route, but what was there was unknown. Mankind was finally going where no man has gone before. And he was listening to Sal pitch the new Kolgomo Adar 2007 to another unsuspecting client while picking at his Ordundrorob beetle soup. Most Adar food was incompatible with human systems. The Adar had, after all, evolved on a completely different planet. Even basic sugars were stereoisomers. Isomers were chemicals in which certain bonds could go in either direction. All the sugar isomers of Earth were so-called left isomers. Adar sugars were right isomers. Many Adar foods were so incompatible as to be poisonous. But over the last 7 years, humans and Adar had found a surprising number of dishes and drinks, starting with Coca-Cola, that each species could consume. Oh, it was usually the nutritional equivalent of eating sawdust, but the food was good. And since there was zero nutritional content, it was the killer diet food. Bill, mostly due to spending all his damned time sitting at a desk lately, had started to pad on a few pounds. Given that he'd once been champion class at mountain biking and karate, the tub was eating at him. Ergo, Adar food. On the other hand, I've got a meeting at 13:30, Bill said as Sal finished his call, finally. The answer is, I'm not in that branch of procurement. I don't do procurement, and I think your system sucks. If you're looking for me to say good words about it, look elsewhere. Bill, buddy, Sal said, shaking his head. You don't have to be that way. Yes, I do, Bill replied. I'm a damned government employee these days, Sal. I'm going to have to do paperwork on this lunch. I'm going to have to pick up the bill or go Dutch, and I've got a 40-minute drive back to the docks. All that to be pitched on a system we both know is crap. Okay, Sal said, holding up his hands. Seriously, I agree with you. Faz Glim and Dulaul don't know diddly about servers. We both know that. So, do you know any good Adar that are in the market? Why couldn't you just come out and say that, Sal? Bill asked, tonguing up another mouthful of noodles. I don't, but I know who to ask. Good enough? We really need a good Adar working in our code department, Sal said. We're losing ground to Loch Lilag. They've got Gelankalka heading up their department. We can't compete with him. Whoever it is going to want something like a CIO position, Bill pointed out. You know that. I was told by very senior people to ask, Sal said. I'll ask around, Bill said. Ring. Command. Bill. Your bill is 29.47, his earring phone replied. 15% tip will be 4.42. Command. Add tip. Pay bill, Bill said, standing up. Command off. See you, Sal. Good to see you again, Bill, Sal said, standing up. I should have gotten at least half. I needed to run, Weaver replied, shaking his hand. He'd gotten some malleagle sauce on his khakis, and he wiped at it with the nanny nap. The napkin, which had active nanites that aggressively sought out and removed stains, should have swept the stain clean, but all it did was rub it in. Of course, if they'd been washed too many times. Weaver shook his head and walked out. What a day. You could have given me more warning, Mimi said, acerbically to apparently nothing. It's not like we didn't know it was going to happen. Yes, but you're not the one that has to convince Aunt Vera. Sure, but you know that she's going to mock a brick. Mimi Jones was 14, short for her age, slight to figure, with long brown hair. She currently lived with her aunt and uncle, her mother having died in the Chen event, and was in the 8th grade gifted program at Dr. Phillips Middle School in Orlando, Florida. She was actually in two separate programs. Fortunately for Mimi, Dr. Phillips Middle School, which catered primarily to families that were upper middle class in income, had a very open-minded approach to their gifted program. For most of the children in the gifted program, there was a set schedule of classes with some electives and independent study. In Mimi's case, she was entirely in independent study. In fact, Mimi would have been, in earlier times, ready to graduate. From college. You see, Mimi had a friend, and the friend was very smart. Smart enough and capable enough to take the child on adventures of the mind far beyond those of the classroom. When Mimi was 6, she had lived on Mendel Terrace, Orlando, in a small two-bedroom apartment with her mother, Loretta Jones. Mendel Terrace was less than a half a mile from the center of the event that destroyed the University of Central Florida, and on that particular morning, Mimi had been watching cartoons when everything suddenly went black. Mimi's recollection of the subsequent period had been investigated several times. All that she could remember was being in a black space. Then there was someone, or more likely something, who was there, for some value of there. The person, thing, entity, or whatever, comforted her. And then she was back on Earth, in the darkness, lying in rubble with a new friend. The friend was a large brown spider thing that looked very much like a stuffed toy. It said its name was Tuffy, for values of said. The best Mimi had ever been able to explain is that knowledge appeared in her head as if she had always had it. Mimi had then gotten up and gone to the light. The light, Klieg lights, in fact, had been set up at the base studying the brand new Chen anomaly. Mimi's brief period in some otherwhere had taken most of that day, and it was nearly midnight when she stumbled into a group that was taking a break from studying the enigmatic black globe that was Ray Chen's final legacy. Among those present was William Weaver, Ph.D., who at the time had no idea of the wonders he was about to experience. Already worried about potential biological contamination, a deputy sheriff, against Weaver's advice, had attempted to relieve Mimi of her new friend. Tuffy had extended 2 of his 10 legs, extended or extruded some claws, and zapped the deputy with what was later suspected to be about 4,000 volts of electricity. After that, nobody tried to take Tuffy away from Mimi. Even her school had allowed the alien friend, the word pet was never used, to attend with her. During his investigation of the anomaly, Weaver had experienced some very strange events. One of them was either a vivid hallucination or a period of time outside the universe, a place that had no definition of real for anyone, even the most out-there physicist. In that time of untime, he had either met other Tuffies or had hallucinated them. However, some of the revelations that had come from the sojourn indicated to him that Tuffies were real, for values of real, and that the being that rode on Mimi's shoulder was from that unplace. In fact, there was an argument he occasionally had with himself as to whether Tuffy was in fact God, or at least some reasonable approximation. Whatever Tuffy might be, he was definitely smart, and he had helped Mimi to become smart as well. There were very few researchers that Mimi and Tuffy trusted enough to let close, but a few had managed to ask enough questions of Mimi to get a feel for what was going on between the two. Initially, from the point of view of study, Tuffy had simply acted as a helpmate, expertly creating scenarios for Mimi that had assisted her in her own understanding of the work placed in front of her by teachers. However, as time passed, Tuffy had begun using that basis to take Mimi farther and faster than the teachers believed possible. By the time Mimi had left the third grade, she was already exploring algebra, trigonometry, and the beginnings of astrophysics with Tuffy. As she passed through subsequent grades, she accelerated faster, so that by the time she was in the seventh, she was at a college level in all of the hard sciences, with a massive knowledge as well of history, psychology, anthropology, and even theology. Mimi's aunt and uncle were very devout Christians, and in general believers that the only book that people needed to read was the Bible. However, they had indulged Mimi's passion for eclectic reading, especially since a good bit of it was theological. Their minister, who had a Ph.D. in theology, had pointed out that knowing the details of other religions was not a sin, and in fact vital for a truer understanding of Christianity. They had, however, drawn the line at certain texts on human physiology and aberrant psychology. So Mimi had just looked the data up on the internet, easily bypassing the child protection programs with Tuffy's help. Lately, Mimi had become more helpful with some researchers. The reason was simple: money. The Wilsons lived in one of the less affluent areas around Dr. Phillips, and Mr. Wilson was a carpenter whose income was enough to keep Mimi in relative comfort. But Mimi and Tuffy realized that in the near future they were going to need more money than that, if for no other reason than to keep up with Mimi's researches. Mimi had, therefore, begun to contact some very senior researchers and offered to assist them in knotty questions they were stuck on. Whether it was Mimi or Tuffy answering questions like the 7 Millennium Prize problems was never quite clear, but the questions were answered. The Clay Mathematics Institute of Cambridge, Massachusetts, or the CMI, as it is known in mathematics circles, identified 7 problems in mathematics that had eluded scientists and mathematicians for enduring periods of time. The CMI offered a $1 million award for each solution. Mimi, more or less out of the blue, had submitted solutions to 4 of the 7 unsolved problems. Although the solutions had been available for review for more than the 2-year required review period, the mathematics community did not consider Mimi as a member of the community, so she was slow-rolled on the payment. Specifically, and relevant to the Higgs bosons, the Chen anomaly and the gates was her solution to the quantum Yang-Mills theory. Before the Chen anomaly and the Dreen had come, the laws of quantum physics had been to the world of elementary particles what Newton's laws of classical mechanics had been to the macroscopic world for centuries. Quantum physics had become the base theory from which to start informing any new concept, as Newton's laws had been a century before. Where Newton's laws described how things in the macroscopic world moved and reacted in general around mundane gravitational fields, any odd things, such as black holes, required Einstein's general relativity. Similarly, quantum mechanics described particle physics fairly well, until the Chen anomaly. In the mid-1950s, Yang and Mills developed a method to describe the interactions of elementary particles using an approach that implements various structures, also found in geometry. And they showed how to use the theory to predict particular elementary particle actions. Yang-Mills was more a description of particle actions than an explanation of them. The theory had been verified experimentally, but there was no underlying model that supported the theory. The theory itself is basically a gauge theory, like the Higgs boson theory that enables the prediction of particles which interact via the so-called strong force. The strong force interactions depend on a subtle quantum mechanical property called the mass gap. Quantum particles have positive masses, even though the classical waves travel at the speed of light, which is in contradiction, or at the least, counterintuitive to Einstein's special relativity. According to special relativity, a particle with mass can't reach the speed of light within the normal universe because it would take an infinite amount of energy. But some quantum particles appear to violate this, hence the mass gap. Mimi's mathematical proof finally explained this violation. Mimi, or perhaps Tuffy, had surmised that the fractal path the looking glass bosons, or LGBs, as they were now discussed in math and physics circles, took after the Chen anomaly was through a dimension of the space-time continuum that was outside those governed by even the multiple manifold dimensions of string theory, but was a modified string theory that resembled the newer membrane theories. Interestingly enough, the new field required for the LGBs encompassed the Higgs field that permeates all of the universe at any instant, and therefore the Higgs boson was a subset, or actually an unstable relativistic version, of the LGBs. For the first time, humanity had an understanding of the connectivity of the LGBs and how it worked. Best of all, this new field required a mass gap at its fundamental level. Eureka! Yang-Mills theory explained. Mimi had discussed this with her friend Dr. Weaver ad nauseam. Dr. William Weaver was first to surmise that the gates were Higgs bosons, which created an insurmountable amount of mock from experimental particle physicists, who assumed they knew everything, and that the so-called standard model of modern physics was an end-all, be-all description of the universe. In fact, the standard model was nothing more than matching experimental data with mathematical descriptions, not a true theory that could predict quantum actions. And Mimi, Dr. Weaver, and Tuffy were realizing that there were few scientists and mathematicians on Earth who would accept the subtle difference. Weaver and Mimi had used the analogy that describing light as photons or particles was still a curve fit to data, and that light is light. That didn't go over well with the particle physicists either, as Feynman had told them all that light was a particle, and therefore it must be. The Adar had often found this trait of human scientists, who were supposed to be open-minded, as an extremely hypocritical and humorous aspect of humanity. So, Mimi, at Weaver's request, had actually stopped referring to these different Higgs bosons as Higgs bosons, when in fact they both understood that that is exactly what they were. Or better yet, the Higgs bosons were actually a non-stationary and unstable version of what the LGBs really were. When it came to fighting the inbred physics community, Weaver had often told Mimi that he preferred fighting the Dreen. Tuffy usually kept quiet on the subject. However, what Mimi actually did generate was the theoretical prediction of Yang-Mills. The theory that fell out of the math she had uncovered was not only the theoretical prediction of the Yang-Mills gauge, but a whole heck of a lot more. It had become known as the 4 plus 1 plus 6 formalism, where there were the four dimensions of space from membrane theory, one of time, and six other dimensions that varied between forms used in both string and membrane concepts. But it was Mimi's mathematical wizardry that tied them all together, including the LGBs, and that not only described the quantum Yang-Mills theory, but predicted it. The CMI had continued to slow roll her in the payout until she had finally used one of her two ace cards. Her number one ace card, of course, was Tuffy, but she didn't go that far. Her second ace card had been Dr. William Weaver, who, other than Mimi, was the planet's expert on the LGBs. Although Dr. Weaver had been spending most of his time of late learning the application of the LGBs and not the fundamentals, he was very politically connected, perhaps even more so now that he was a Navy officer. When the director of the CMI received a phone call from the National Security Advisor as a favor to Weaver, the CMI finally got off their dime and at least paid Mimi for the one solution. Mimi, still puzzled over Weaver's remark about the stagnant, inbred, not invented here eggheads, Weaver had also used several other southern euphemisms and metaphors that Mimi's aunt wouldn't allow her to repeat. Tuffy had told her not to give it much thought. The industrial complex, on the other hand, had no such not invented here problem. Clever entrepreneurs used any good source of information from which to make money, and in Mimi's and Tuffy's cases, they were crawling out of the woodwork to pay them. Mimi had been integral in the reverse engineering of the Adar miniature power supplies for communications implants, which left her with 1% of a patent that one of the major cellular networks owned, not to mention a slice of just about every battery being made in the market. There was one armored glass manufacturer that asked her to help them decipher a problem with a new polymer manufacturing process. After a few months of her working with the company, a new patent for an aluminum titanium oxide and magnesium sulfide compound layered in precise alternating optical thicknesses was developed that ended up being as strong as aluminum, or better, and optically transparent. The company gave Mimi 7% of that patent. Dubbed Alleyglass, since transparent aluminum was too over the top, the material was beginning to replace glass in every skyscraper in the world, not to mention parts in most armored systems. It was a somewhat lucrative contract. Each time Mimi and Tuffy would be involved with such solution endeavors, Mimi always refused the aid of a contracts or patents lawyer or accountant. Tuffy seemed to have a preternatural knowledge of the actual value attached to a piece of information, and the team was very good at writing ironclad contracts. And when the negotiations were face-to-face, even the toughest corporate lawyer found negotiating with a soft-spoken 14-year-old, who just might have God riding on her shoulder,
extremely disconcerting. Some of the money they earned they gave to the Wilsons, in thanks for taking care of Mimi. Most of it, however, was spent on books, or put in the bank. At this point, Mimi had a bank account that would have made any accountant smile. The time had come, though, to spend some of it. Which was why Mimi, wearing a light blue dress and dress shoes, was sitting on her bed with her hands clasped in her lap, looking out the window and lightly tapping her thumbs together. At her feet was a packed suitcase. Tuffy had changed over the years. Actually, most of the changes had occurred quite recently. His once stubby limbs had increased in length, and now had definite little claws that glittered a silvery purple. His fur had also darkened to almost midnight black that flashed purple in the right light. In addition, he had developed eyes, or eye spots, that were a bright emerald green. Around the eye spots were patches of purple fur, sometimes blue, that were narrow and curved. The changes had baffled most of the researchers who were trying to study him, until one of them, a female, had pointed out that Tuffy now looked, well, cool. When Tuffy had first appeared, and for many years thereafter, Mimi had needed comfort. She was a child, and needed a teddy bear, or spider in this case, to hug and keep away the nightmares. Puberty had changed that. Mimi had suffered few of the extreme mood swings of that period in life, but she had changed nonetheless. She had put away childish things, and in keeping with that, perhaps Tuffy had morphed to be more of what a young teenager, recently a child, but now exploring the world of adulthood needed, somebody cool and tough-looking. Or he might just be aging. Nobody really knew, except Tuffy and maybe Mimi, and they weren't talking. "Okay, okay," Mimi said with an exasperated sigh. She got up and walked into the living room where Mrs. Wilson was vacuuming with the TV on in the background. "Aunt Vera," Mimi said over the sound of the vacuum. "Mimi," Vera said, shutting off the machine. Vera Wilson was a heavyset woman in her 40s, currently wearing a muumuu since the Wilsons kept the thermostat high to save energy. "You're dressed nice for school." "I'm not going," Mimi said. "Tuffy has told me I have to go visit someone. Today." "You're..." "What?" Vera Wilson asked, confused. Since taking Mimi in, she had found her to be a very biddable and charming young lady, the daughter she'd never had. Mimi had never asked to skip school, and had certainly never back-talked or said anything this strange.
"What do you mean you're not going to school?"
"Tuffy has something that I need to do," Mimi said, calmly but definitely. "I need to go visit someone, and then, well, I'll probably be gone for a while, but there will be adults who will talk to you about it. But I have to leave now, this morning. We have a transfer from the gateport at 10, and there's a taxi on the way."
"Young lady, you can't just walk out of this house,"
Vera Wilson started to respond angrily. "I don't want to make you mad, Aunt Vera," Mimi continued calmly, "but I really need to go. I'm not running away. Some adults will come explain, I'm sure, but I'm not sure what I can say to you about it. You remember when Dr. Weaver came to visit that one time, and he said it was confidential? It's secret like that."
"Well, if the government wants you to go, why didn't they tell me?"
Mrs. Wilson asked, confused.
"They don't know I have to go," Mimi said. "But Tuffy says that if I don't, it's not going to work."
"What's not going to work?"
Mrs. Wilson said, totally out of her depth.
"The thing I can't talk about," Mimi said, as the taxi honked its horn. "That's my ride. I've got to go. I'll write, and I'll probably be back, maybe soon for a week or so, if you'll let me come back. But it's time for me to do the things I'm supposed to do. I think it's sort of like being called by God, Auntie Vera. I have a calling, and the first place it will take me is San Diego."
Aunt Vera looked at the cool-looking spider thing on Mimi's shoulder and sighed. She'd had a very confusing but interesting conversation with Dr. Weaver at one point when he visited Mimi to thank her for her help. After that, she'd had to wonder. Do angels always appear in a cloud of light? Or, as Dr. Weaver had pointed out, "Well, we got the big light, and the city was certainly smited or smitten or whatever. I don't know exactly what Tuffy is, but from what I went through, an angel in heavy disguise is a pretty good description. But God sure worked in mysterious ways. You just had to have the patience of Job and trust that it would all come out right."
"You right, you hear?"
Aunt Vera said, tearing up. She and Herman had never been able to have children, and Mimi had been, in a way, a gift from God. Now, it seemed, the time was come to lose the gift. She'd thought they'd have more years. She hugged the girl to her and sniffled.
"I got the hang of that email thing. You be sending me emails, you hear, girl? And come home when you got a chance. This is always home."
"I will," Mimi said, sniffling herself. "But where I'm going, well, I don't think there's email."
Chapter 2. Welcome to the Space Marines. Please keep your hands and feet away from the monsters. Private First Class Eric Bergstresser parked his Jeep outside headquarters and got out, stretching his back. Berg's first intimation he was being transferred had been the previous day, when his team, NCOIC, a staff sergeant, had dragged him out to morning PT and told him to get his ass up to battalion. Upon reaching the battalion headquarters, he had been put through the one fastest post-clearance in history, according to the gunnery sergeant from S3, who had walked the private through, then handed him orders to proceed via personal automobile to Bravo Company, Marine Corps Force Reconnaissance, which was based, oddly enough, at Newport News Naval Base. Berg hadn't even known there were any Marines at Newport News, which, as far as he knew, was still in the process of closure. He was more than surprised to find out there was a Force Recon Company there. Berg was a nugget, a nug. The new guy in the battalion. He had volunteered immediately upon reaching the 1st Marine Division, his initial duty station after basic. After taking the initial entry tests, mental and physical, he'd gone through the short hell of recon in process and the much longer hell of force recon operator training. After the Dreen War, force recon qualification had been revamped to concentrate more and more on off-planet operations. It had also gotten harder to qualify. Of the 60 volunteers in the class with Berg, he had been one of only 4 to pass the full course. While not quite as hard as Delta qualification and training, it was equivalent to or surpassed SEAL buds, at least in sheer brutality. Berg wasn't sure what was happening to the Corps he had wanted to join for so long, but he was seeing changes that were interesting. Unlike most troops, he paid a lot of attention to things like the budget fights in Congress and current events. And in the former, especially, there were some odd things happening. After the Dreen War and the closing of the various gates that had permitted the Dreen to invade Earth, most of the forces had suffered serious cutbacks. The still unexplained breakouts of Dreen infestations in several Islamic countries had taken most of the starch out of the Great Jihad. And while U.S. troops were still deployed around the world, mostly they were back to peace enforcement, or peacekeeping missions. The war on terror had died, along with several hundred thousand jihadists, in the Bekaa Valley, Mecca, and Iran. But while the Army and the Air Force were getting their budgets slashed, most of the money wasn't being reinvested. It was going to the Navy and the Marines, and most of it was going into black holes. The black portions of the budget were getting large enough to cause some serious questions in the news media. The only information slipping out was that the expenditures involved extraterrestrial military research projects. He'd been directed to the windowless block building by the gate guard on reaching Newport News, one long-ass drive from Lejeune. Now it was time to find out just what this company of Force Recon was doing, and why it was hidden away in a secure building in Newport News. Entering the door marked Visitor's Entrance, he found himself in a small room composed of mostly concrete walls. Directly opposite the door was a plane of what he recognized to be alley glass, with a security station behind its protection. He knew that it was technically transparent aluminum, but it looked more like transparent sapphire, 10 times as strong as plexiglass, and still expensive as hell. A sheet of it meant somebody seriously wanted to stop an attack. The inch-and-a-half-thick window would shrug off an armor penetrator round. "Bergstresser Eric, PFC," he said, holding up his ID to the guard behind the glass. The guard was a civilian, not a Marine. But he was relatively young and armed for war, with an MP7 on a 3-point combat strap hooked into his chest, boron carbide helmet, and heavy body armor. "I'm reporting for duty." "Hold your ID up to the scanner," the guard said, gesturing with his chin. The guard checked his computer, then nodded. "Hold there for escort." "Aye, aye," Berg said, taking a position of parade rest. "Nugget?" the guard asked through the intercom, smiling slightly. "Yes, sir," Berg replied. "I've only been in recon for 3 months. "I used to be recon," the guard said, glancing at his monitors. "Welcome to Wonderland. Here comes your escort." The heavy steel door to the room opened, and a first sergeant in MarCam stepped into the small room. The first sergeant was tall and slender, with hair cropped so short it was hard to tell the color, hazel eyes, and a slightly oversized nose. His right jaw was slightly protruding, the muscle clearly much larger than the left's, a sure sign of a person who spent a lot of time in Wyvern battle armor. "Bergstresser?" the first sergeant asked. His name tag read Powell. "Yes, first sergeant," the PFC replied. "ID?" the first sergeant said, holding out his hand. He checked the ID and nodded. "Welcome to the unit. I'm going to handle your in-brief, then turn you over to your team NCOIC. Follow me." "Yes, First Sergeant," Berg said, following the NCO into an even smaller room. The First Sergeant waited until the outer door was closed, then cleared his throat. "Clearing 14. The inner door, marked with a large red numeral 14, slid aside, revealing a corridor. They took a right and headed down the highly polished tile floor, passing several doors. Unlike at Berg's previous station, none of the doors had titles on them, only numbers. And most of them were sliding doors similar to the ones he'd entered the building by. For that matter, every 10 feet or so, there was a black pod on the ceiling that indicated a security camera. The interior of the building looked less like a headquarters than a prison. The first sergeant stopped about halfway down the long corridor and cleared his throat again. "Entering 7-6.
7-6 opening," a robotic voice replied as the door opened. 5-4.
"Come on," the first sergeant said, stepping through quickly. At 0, the door slid closed, with Bergstresser barely clearing it. "Hate that system," said the Marine behind the desk in the office they'd entered.
"So do I," the first sergeant replied. "But it's there for a reason. Come on, Berg," he added, opening the door marked First Sergeant.
The first sergeant took a seat behind the desk and looked Bergstresser up and down. The PFC had come to parade rest again, legs spread shoulder-width apart, hands folded behind his back, and was staring at a point 6 inches over the first sergeant's head.
"Rest," Powell said, ordering him to keep more or less the same posture, but the PFC could talk.
"I've read your service record. You were selected for this unit because of your IQ, your MGT scores, and your scores in operator training. But I'm going to ask you a few questions, and I need straight answers. If you are wrong for this unit, then I need to send you back to your old unit. There won't be any repercussions on that, trust me. But this unit can only afford certain types of candidates. I'd rather go on a mission short than with an unsuitable candidate. I'll add that you're going to be tested on some of the questions if we have time. If we don't, and you've been anything other than perfectly truthful, you're probably going to get people killed. Are we clear?"
"Clear, First Sergeant," Berg said, wondering what the hell was going on.
Have you ever suffered any form of the slightest anxiety at confined spaces? The first sergeant asked. For that matter, have you ever been in any confined spaces for any duration to test that?
I have never been in confined spaces for any significant time, First Sergeant, the PFC replied. I have spent small amounts of time in normal confined spaces and never had any anxiety.
Define normal confined space, the First Sergeant said evenly.
I used to play around culverts, First Sergeant, Berg said. I've even gotten stuck in one. It didn't worry me.
Not really what I'm looking for, the First Sergeant said.
Have you ever considered what it might be like to be in a submarine?
Yes, First Sergeant, Berg said. I don't think I'll have any issues.
Here's a kicker, the First Sergeant said, leaning forward.
Have you ever considered what it would actually be like to be in space?
Like being an astronaut in a spacesuit outside a ship? No air anywhere around for billions of miles, and the only thing between you and a horrible death being a suit built by the lowest bidder?
Yes, First Sergeant, I have, Berg said. I considered trying to get in the astronaut program, but I've wanted to be a Marine for most of my life. I don't see a tour in the Marines as necessarily standing in the way of that. Worked for John Glenn.
You've got the IQ for it, the First Sergeant admitted, leaning back.
Ever read any science fiction, Berg?
Yes, First Sergeant, Berg Stresser replied.
He knew that that was as much an admission that he was a geek, but the First Sergeant had insisted on honest answers.
What? The First Sergeant asked.
Or rather, how much?
Quite a bit, Berg admitted, knowing that it was probably going to be a down check.
Define quite a bit, the First Sergeant said. How many books? How many dealing with space travel? What sort of background on it do you have?
Books, not TV shows or movies.
I have a library at home of over 1,000 books, First Sergeant, Berg admitted reluctantly. I read all the time, both paper and ebooks. I've written game programs for space combat maneuvers. I'm a gamer and have played board games, role-playing games, and computer games that deal with space combat. I'm aware that that categorizes me as a geek, First Sergeant, but I also
made it through the new qual course, the First Sergeant said, smiling tightly. Shiny, you're just what I was looking for.
Huh? Berg said, astounded. It was hardly the response he was expecting.
For your general FYI, Berg, my IQ is higher than yours, the First Sergeant said mildly.
So, you seriously have thought about what it would be like to be in death pressure?
Yes, First Sergeant, Berg replied.
Space is a stone-cold bitch. I wrote a paper on it in high school as part of a book report on Have Spacesuit, Will Travel. The book is about a young man who wins a spacesuit.
I'm familiar with it, the First Sergeant said dryly.
Now the big question. This unit is going to be going on long deployments off-planet. The risk of loss of life is high. Most of it is going to be boring as hell, with occasional moments, I am certain, of sheer terror. Actual conditions are unknown. But I would be unsurprised if casualty rates exceed 30% permission. I am saying that in my professional opinion, you, PFC, Eric Bergstresser, have a 1 in 3 chance of dying. Possibly higher. Possibly much higher. And I cannot tell you the nature of the mission until you volunteer for said mission. So I'm asking, knowing the risks, do you wish to volunteer?
Yes, First Sergeant, Berg said instantly. I wish to volunteer for this unit.
Shiny, the First Sergeant said with a sigh. You're in. But if we get the time, I'm going to put you in the tank and see how you really handle pressure.
Welcome to the Space Marines, PFC Bergstresser. Semper Fi ad Astra, if you will.
Holy muck, Berg whispered, when his new platoon sergeant led him into the platoon office. He wasn't kidding.
On the wall was a large poster, placed in much the same way that a corporate motivational poster might be hung. But this poster was a picture taken in space of a portion of what could only be a spaceship. the top of which was lined with suits of wyvern armor. Over each suit was a name, and he quickly picked out First Sergeant Powell, as well as his platoon sergeant, Gunnery Sergeant Josh Hosianic. And there was no question it was a picture. Even with all the advances in computer-generated images, it was still possible to spot CGI. This was unquestionably a picture. They might have been digitized in, but it didn't look like it. No, Top wasn't kidding, the senior NCO said. Hosianic was shaved bald, short, barely over regulation height, unless Berg was much wrong, and skinny. He looked as if he could barely carry himself around, much less battle rattle. You just joined the Space Marines. The mawky part for you is that the rest of us have been training for this for a year or more, and we're leaving day after tomorrow. Oh, mawk, Berg said, his eyes wide. You're replacing Harson, Hosianic continued, sitting down at his desk, because the dick for brains broke his grappling femur on a fast rope climb 2 days ago. Welcome to hell, Nugget, a staff sergeant said, looking up from some paperwork. Staff Sergeant Summerlin, you're going to be with Jane, Charlie team. The staff sergeant was medium height and slim with dark brown hair. Summerlin's alpha team leader and assistant platoon sergeant, the gunny said. Jane and Hat are over on the ship doing maintenance on their wyverns. So while Summer here does my paperwork for me, I'm going to get you into the barracks and through in processing. And this is the gaming room, Sergeant Janish said, opening the door. The barracks and training area for the Space Marines was about a quarter mile from the headquarters. The barracks were pretty decent, Starbase apartment barracks, left over from the Navy when they'd pulled most of their people out of Newport News. There was enough room that the Marines were rattling around in them like peas. They even got individual rooms, since there were enough barracks for a regular battalion, much less a Space Marine company, which was about the size of a regular platoon. A company is a variable term. Originally, the term simply meant a body of companions. Latterly, it came to mean a group of about 100 infantry personnel under the leadership of an officer who was not quite a junior, not quite a senior, usually a captain. However, companies varied in size. Force Recon companies had ranged as high as 200 when all the supports were added over the years. With the shift to Space Marines, the Marine Corps Commandant had taken a step back. Since the Recon companies were going to be ship-based, the Navy could damned well handle support. And given their firepower, training, and individual lethality, the size of the actual unit could be dropped. However, retaining the leadership as a captain made sense. Young enough to carry the fight, old enough to do so wisely, and without the mandated lobotomies of majors. Delta would call it a troop. SEALs would call it a team. The Marines called it a company of Space Marines. If the Navy ever got bigger ships, they'd reevaluate. In the meantime, the Marines got all the hot water they could ask for. The training building was part of the base gym. There wasn't a regular shoot house or a range short of Quantico, but part of the funds had provided a pretty decent alternative. The game room was a new building, solid concrete, including the roof, attached to the gym, and about as large. It also was nearly empty. There was a small entry room with some lockers and computer terminals and beyond, viewable through a sheet of plexiglass that was liberally splashed with blue splatters, was a cavernous, empty room. On the far side were huge rollback doors, large enough to slide a business jet into the room. It looked more like a hangar than a training area. Virtual reality? Berg asked. Got it in one, Janish said, walking over to a computer terminal. We've got just about every game on the market available on this thing, but we generally use the one designed for the mission, a hack of Dreen War. Janish opened up some windows on screen and started a game up, then opened up one of the lockers, pulling out two sets of VR gear. The gear consisted of a light harness, gloves, and a pair of glasses. The VR glasses, thanks mostly to Adar Tech, had reduced to the size of wraparound sunglasses. The newest military combat goggles were similar in size and structure. Berg had even heard that DARPA was working on combat lenses that could be worn as contacts. That would be interesting. Janish also handed him an M10 and combat harness, preloaded with simulated rounds. Simulation rounds used actual gunpowder to fire low-velocity paint rounds that mimicked real bullets fairly well at short ranges. They required a special barrel and breech, but the M10 had already been modified for them and had the standard blue training barrel. The glasses stayed clear until they walked in the room, then darkened momentarily, and came back showing a jungle scene. It wasn't anywhere on Earth. Both the trees and sounds were wrong, and it took Berg a moment to adjust. "Where are we supposed to be?" he sub-vocalized. When they passed basic, every Marine was fitted with combat implants that consisted of a small microphone implanted next to the vocal cords and a receiver in the mastoid bone. Learning to sub-vocalize was a requirement of Marine basic training. The system was virtually identical to the one the Adar used when they first reached Earth. For a short time, it had been thought that the Adar were telepaths, since using the system looked much the same to an ignorant observer. There was virtually no sound involved, and only short bursts of radio. "This is based on Chen's world," Janish replied sub-vocally, his lips moving only slightly. "But it's got different monsters. All we have to do is make it to the far wall." He hefted a virtual M10 and was now, in the goggles, wearing full battle rattle, a set of boron carbide body armor with fitted pouches for ammunition. "You've got left. I'll take right." Berg jacked around into his own M10, flicked the weapon off safe, and nodded. "Let's do it." Janish led off, following a narrow game trail. Berg kept his attention to the left, sweeping forward, up and to the rear. There were some light heat forms in his glasses, but nothing that looked like a threat. A thunderous roar from the right almost made him spin around, but he kept on his sector, and it was a good thing. Just as the roar faded, a form came charging through the jungle. It was bipedal and looked something like a more insectile Dreen thorn thrower. Whatever it was, it had a big mouth, and Berg wasn't going to take any chances. He fired two rounds into center of mass and was unsurprised that the 7.62mm rounds bounced off. But the thing had big multiple eye systems, and he retargeted, hitting it in the eyes and blinding it. The thing continued its rush, but missed the two Marines, and Berg pounded it with single-fire shots as it crashed past. He found a weak point under one of its arms and pumped five rounds into the spot until the thing dropped, thrashing. "Reloading," he sub-vocalized, trying to keep his sector in sight as he pulled out a magazine. He got the reload in place just in time to spot something dropping from the trees. It looked like a sheet of paper, but it was headed either for the Marines or the dead beast. Berg fired at it, and the sheet ripped apart, falling in tatters. Janish had been firing at something as well, and the two Marines went back to back as more of the bipedal monsters came through the jungle after them. Berg picked his shots more carefully, since he only had 30 of the 7.62mm rounds in a clip. He managed to drop three of the monsters before he ran out of ammo. The fourth and fifth, though, got him, and the jungle vanished as the harness gave him a zap of electricity. "Grab me," he said, shaking his head. "Not bad, actually," Janish said, looking over at him. "I'm going to reset the system so we've also got 455s. You qualified on the 455? "Yes," Berg said. The high-velocity Colt Magnum was rarely used by combat forces, but he'd qualified with one in force operators training. He had wondered at the time why they were training on a civilian gun nut pistol that no other force considered worth its time. Now he had to wonder how much FOT was influenced by the Space Marines, a group that officially didn't exist. They returned to the prep room and added the big magnums to their kit. The gun's blue barrel was nearly a foot long, and it was a heavy mother. But civilian hunters had used them to hunt both elephant and tiger at short ranges. It should stop even one of the bipedal monsters. He stopped before going back and readjusted the position of the ammo pouches on his armor. Every serious shooter had his own idea of where stuff should ride, and Berg wasn't any different. "Same general scenario?" he asked, as they re-entered the jungle. "It changes," Janish said. "You never know what's going to come at you." Berg kept a watch out as they re-entered the path, and while it was a different beast, they attacked at the same point. This time they got low-slung, bright red centipedes, about the size of a leopard, and there were more of them than of the bipedal monsters, and the 7.62mm rounds just bounced off again. He let go of the M10, which pulled back to his chest on its straps, and drew the .455 Colt. The magnum rounds did penetrate the centipede's armor, and even better, he was a very good one-handed shooter. He fired all 10 of the rounds in his magazine, getting 6 of the beasts, then did a rapid reload by just dropping his empty mag down the front of his armor and sliding another in. He got 4 more before they got him at last. "This seriously sucks," Berg said, holstering his smoking pistol. "Hell, you held out longer than I did," Janish said, shaking his head. "I stayed on the M10. Where'd you learn to shoot like that?" "I just enjoy shooting," Berg said carefully. The real answer was in Force Recon operators training. Force Recon had always been a tough unit with a killer qualification phase, but its advanced training had mostly been ad hoc at the unit level. The new FOT included an operator combat training program that far exceeded the normal Force Recon official training program. He was beginning to realize that the regular Force Recon guys might have much more experience than he did, but he was probably better trained. He was going to have to tread that path very carefully. "Can you two-gun mojo?" Janish asked. "A bit," Berg said, "but I can't fire simultaneously. That's total bullmock. Usually what I do is empty one pistol, then empty the other one. The problem is, it really slows down reload. So if you got more targets than you've got bullets..." "Want to try it that way?" Janish asked. "I'll stay one gun on pistol. You go for two gun?" "I'll try it," Berg said. "But I'll stay on M10 to start, since we don't know what it's going to throw at us." "I'll set it up for the same scenario," Janish said. "I'm really curious." The third time through, Berg carried 2 of the magnums and Janish 1. The centipedes attacked at the same time and in the same way, which was a bit of cheating, since it meant Berg didn't have to guess where they were coming from. But the two-gun mojo worked. This time, knowing where and how they were going to attack, he managed to start winnowing them down earlier. When his right pistol ran out of rounds, he holstered it and pulled out a clip. When the left ran out, he did a fast reload, then switched hands and went to a two-handed fire position, backing away from the centipedes until he had the last one dead. The things thrashed as they died, splattering green blood over the mostly blue vegetation and opening out the underbrush as they crushed it in their death throes. "Damn," Janish said, shaking his head. "Shiny. Now, let's see if we can make it to the far side of the room." They were hit twice more, but Berg's two-gun fire managed to stop both attacks cold, and they eventually reached the stream that marked the far side of the room. He only had 4 rounds of magnum left, though. "Clear VR," Janish said when they reached the limit. "Not bad, Nugget. Not bad at all." "Thanks," Berg said. "This scenario is set up for a 2-team maneuver," Janish admitted. 6 guys, not 2. I wanted to run you through something harder than I thought we could handle, just to knock the starch out. So much for that idea. As a matter of fact, I hereby designate you 2-gun.
You may now call me Jane.
Thank you, Jane, Berg said, but I don't think it's a good way to do battle normally.
Agreed, Jane said,
but it was grappin' awesome. I can't wait to replay the clip.
This is recorded, Berg said.
Two Gun, every second of every day we do this mock is recorded, Janish said bitterly.
Why do you think there are grappin' cameras everywhere? We're guinea pigs.
I'll explain when we get back to the armory.
Chapter 3. Old Friends, Same Problems. All the Adar tech in the world hadn't helped the lunchtime traffic on Monticello. Bill weaved his Ford Electra into the left-hand lane, getting around a late-model Chevy pickup that was carefully doing the speed limit, and floored it, trying to make it through the turn at VA 168. Once past 168, he'd be clear most of the way to base. Unfortunately, as he approached the light, it turned yellow. He figured he had time, so he floored it, but the car instead decelerated, the electric motor dropping to idle as the brakes automatically slid him to a controlled stop. Oh yeah, Adar tech was good for some things. The pickup blew past him, still doing a stately 45 miles per hour. He hoped the old fart got a ticket. The bright purple Chevy Neon that had been on Bill's bumper suddenly pulled out, the light having changed to red, and sped through the intersection, causing a flurry of honks, but fortunately, no accidents. Speaking of Adar, worst drivers in the world. Christ, could this day get any worse? It wasn't really a florist's shop. It was a shop that supplied flowers for corporations and hotels. The company had no storefront, just a back door through the loading area. And the people who worked in the company were much more accustomed to the occasional street person wandering in and looking for a handout than 14-year-old girls with some alien pet.
Can I help you? The young man, with his arms full of arrangements, asked curiously.
He couldn't help but stare at the thing on her shoulder. As he watched, it moved from one side to the other, its green eyes glittering in interest at the bustle in the room.
I'm looking for Mr. Miller, Mimi said politely. He's over there, the man said, gesturing with his chin, since his hands were full. Go on in.
The room was unadorned and looked more like a half-finished basement than a florist's. White wooden tables were heaped with flowers, while several workers in eclectic attire assembled arrangements. About half were females, but there was as much long hair amongst the men working on the flowers as there was with the women. Most of the men working in the shop were in shorts, as were a couple of the women. It was hot, and the only breath of cold air came as a man exited a huge walk-in refrigeration room, his arms filled with colorful orchids. Miller had his back to the entrance and was peacefully snipping the bottom of some iris stems when Mimi cleared her throat.
Hello, Mr. Miller, Mimi said,
wondering if the former SEAL would recognize her. Miller clearly was puzzled by the young lady who had spoken to him, but after a moment he placed the thing on her shoulder.
Mimi, the SEAL said, grinning. What a pleasant surprise. It's been, what, 7 years? You've grown, and toughies.
Changed, Mimi said, grinning. All the ET people got really excited when that happened. Only one of them got it right, though. I was talking to him one day in school and just sort of thought that I'd gotten over the whole stuffed animal thing, and he looked really dumb that way. The next day, whole new toughie.
You're here on a trip? Miller asked, puzzled.
He was wearing a loud Hawaiian shirt, open most of the way down a chest covered in graying hair, and a pair of cut-off desert camo BDU shorts.
In town for school or something? Why San Diego, of all places?
I'm not here on a school trip, Mimi replied. I came looking for you. We have to go to Newport News and see Dr. Weaver.
What's Bill want?
Miller asked gruffly, turning back to his irises.
He didn't want anything, but there's something he needs, Mimi said. You, me, and Tuffy. Tuffy told me, and we're going.
Oh, we are we? Miller asked, turning back around. I'm out of that game. You get older, you get slower. There's a time to reap and a time to sow, all that stuff. In my case, there's a time to kill and a time to heal. So if you and Tuffy have to do something, you go, girl. I'm going to keep making floral arrangements.
If you don't go, Mimi paused and looked around the crowded room. Can you take a break or something? We have to talk.
Okay, Miller sighed. Bob, going on break. I don't know how long I'll be. That okay?
Sure, Chief, the younger man called back. Try to get those arrangements done by 4, though.
The coffee shop was considerably cooler than the floral factory. It was still early morning, and the tall buildings on either side provided shade from the sun. For that matter, San Diego rarely got hot during the early fall. Only when the Santa Anas blew down from the mountains did the temperature get much above 75. Miller set his mocha down and leaned back in the chair, considering the young lady who had dragged him away from work.
You came all the way out here on your own? Miller asked, surprised.
It's not hard. There's gates all the way to San Diego. Then I took a taxi.
Most of our customers can't find the shop, Miller mused. The boss prefers it that way.
Tuffy knew where to find you, Mimi said, shrugging. He told me he'd been keeping track of you.
That's nice to know, Miller said dryly. So, what's so important that you want me to go to Newport News?
They've finished the ship, Mimi said carefully. It's still covert, and I'm not going to blow that for them. But Tuffy says that I have to be on it with him when it leaves. They've completed the shakedown cruises. The next launch is going to be out. Tuffy says that we, you, me, him, have to be on the ship. I don't know why, and I don't know if he's being cagey or he can't really explain why. I know that part of the reason has to do with causality. That's about as much as I understood. Basically, he's saying that the ship is probably going to fail, and fail big, if we three, don't go along.
Look, you can't just walk up to something like that and say, we're coming along, okay? Miller said, blowing out his cheeks. The security's going to be a mile deep, and the entire crew, and that includes the civilians, are already going to be chosen. That's even assuming that I'm willing to go.
You'll go, Mimi said. You'll go because if you don't, the mission's going to fail. And if the mission fails, it will probably mean the Dreen back. And this time, we'll lose. Plus, Dr. Weaver will die on the mission, and he's your friend.
Friends die, Miller said, his jaw working. One of the reasons that I peacefully make flower arrangements these days is because I've seen lots of friends die. I don't particularly want to meet more people who are probably going to die, which is what going on something like that would mean. Even if we could convince somebody that we had to go along, at which we have a chance in hell.
You need to call Admiral Townsend and get a meeting today, Mimi said. He's somebody you can just call, and he's briefed on the mission. He can get a hold of Dr. Weaver, and Dr. Weaver can get us on the mission.
You seem to know a hell of a lot for a 14-year-old, Miller said, blowing out again, this time angrily. Greg Townsend. Yeah, he'd take my call. But getting us on the mission?
He can get us in touch with Dr. Weaver, Mimi said. That's all we need.
Okay, the former chief said, shaking his head. I guess it's time to call in some favors. And Greg Townsend does owe me. Big time.
Bill parked the Electra in his designated slot and walked quickly towards the massive concrete building that guarded the upgraded sub-pens. Newport News had gotten out of the active sub-business almost 2 decades before, when the full weight of the post-Cold War conditions had hit the Navy. Subsequent to that event, the base had mostly been used for decomming subs, turning them into razor blades, in other words. Most of the subs that were going to be turned into razor blades had been turned when the Navy finally won the battle for the first warp ship.
The battle had long-term consequences that were clear to the admirals. Weaver was pretty sure that with the data they'd gather from use, it was possible to make another warp drive, albeit perhaps not as neat as the little black box. Eventually, the Earth would need a Starfleet, especially if the Dreen ever used warp space to attack. The service that got in on the ground floor was pretty certain to be the eventual space service. Navy was Navy, wet or in space. And that was one of the many arguments that the admirals, often disbelieving the words that came out of their mouths, made. However, the Navy was the right service for a space fleet. The Air Force, which had argued that it had much more experience with three-dimensional combat than the Navy, was based around small systems with short mission times. There was a degree of complexity in creating, and especially running, a ship that was orders of magnitude away from being, say, a squadron or wing commander. There were human complexities that simply didn't occur in the Air Force when you packed a huge number of humans into a small space and then told them they had to get along or else. So the Navy had wholeheartedly offered Newport News when the new boat was under discussion. Out of their own pocket, drawing on funds detailed for other bases and ship maintenance, they had upgraded the facilities to be as state-of-the-art as they could, even before the decision was made. The Air Force had pointed out that, unlike Dreamland, there was no way that a ship taking off from Newport News, by day or night, could remain undetected. The Navy had pointed out that the boat was to be based on a submarine. All it had to do was submerge, get far enough offshore, make sure there wasn't anything in view via sonar, and then take off from there. In the final event, Newport News, a quiet little seaport on Chesapeake Bay, had become the world's first starport. Stranger things had happened, but not many. The outer door to the guard facility was easy enough to pass. All he had to do was wave his card at the reader, and the door opened. Beyond, he was in the blast room. Weaver had been consulted on the design. The room wouldn't quite stop a nuke, but it would stop anything else. There was a single door out of the room. It was designed around a bank vault, unmarked and with a keypad next to it. He swiped his security card past the reader and punched in his code, then went in as the powered door opened. This revealed another room. On the left-hand side was a window of alleyglass. Weaver, Bill said, holding up his ID to the guard. The guard's name was Johnson, Bill remembered. They'd chatted one time in the break room. If Johnson recognized him, it wasn't apparent. Johnson looked carefully at the ID, then consulted a list. Please enter your key code, the guard said in a monotone, still staring at Weaver as if he was a suspected terrorist. Bill swiped his card again and punched in a different code. That door led to a small room, windowless, with a video camera over the far door and a laser to the left. The laser swept over him, doing a retinal and surface temperature scan. The room was a man trap. The inner door was interlocked in such a way as it couldn't open until the outer door had closed. Weaver, William, Lieutenant Commander, Astrogation, a robotic voice intoned. Then the inner door opened. Bill had once done a short stint as a consultant to the NSA. Getting into the National Security Agency involved showing your card to a guard and then walking in. He wasn't sure if this setup was overkill or if the NSA had lousy security, but surely there was somewhere in between. As soon as he got through the final portal, he turned left down the corridor and stopped to check a computer terminal. The meeting he was supposed to be at, in 2 minutes, was in Secure 4, a high-security auditorium. When they'd first started work on the 4144, meetings were getting so turned around that they'd installed this system to keep track. They still got shifted from time to time, so checking it had become habit. The system showed that the meeting was still on time and in the same place, but there was a peripheral note keyed to him saying that he had been canceled as a briefer. He was supposed to report to call a secure extension instead. What the?
Bill flopped into his office chair and punched in the extension, wondering who would answer. 3326. Weaver, he said as calmly as he could.
Commander Weaver, this is Admiral Townsend, the voice said. I'm the base commander at Norfolk. A blast from the past apparently needs to talk to you. Now.
The admiral did not sound happy.
Sir, Bill started to protest and then stopped. If Townsend was saying they needed to meet, now it was something serious.
Where?
My office as soon as you can, the admiral said. You know how to find it?
Yes, sir, Bill replied. I'll be there in about... Well, it's going to take at least 45 minutes.
See you in 1 hour.
The phone clicked off.
Mock. He had to drive back to Norfolk.
When Bill reached the admiral's office, he was surprised as hell to see Chief Miller, in a Hawaiian shirt of all things, waiting in the room, not to mention Mimi and Tuffy.
Good to see you, Bill said, puzzled but pleased. Long time, Chief.
You can trip down memory lane later, Townsend replied. Apparently our security isn't as tight as we would have liked.
I don't think that you can really say that, sir, Miller replied unhappily. There's no real way to tell how Tuffy got the information.
Go ahead and explain, young lady, the admiral said, leaning back in his chair.
Tuffy says that we, that is Mr. Miller, myself, and Tuffy, have to go along with you on the ship, Mimi said calmly. You have a warp ship, converted from a submarine, docked at Newport News, Naval Construction Contract 4144. You're leaving in about a week. Chief Miller needs to be outfitted with a Wyvern 5. That's why we had to meet today. He'll need to get started tomorrow.
Just like that? Bill asked, amused. Does Tuffy say why?
Not really,
Mimi said, showing the first sign of agitation.
Usually we communicate with concepts, not really words. I just realized that I've known something all along. But this time, it's like I can't understand what I know. There's math in there. That's mostly what it is. Very high-end math. Further than I've gone. Maybe further than you've gone, Dr. Weaver. But it's locked up in causality and chaos. The concept is just very big. I think what he's trying to say, although he says I'm wrong, that it's more, is that if we don't go along and stay with the missions in the future, the universe is going to end. Not the Earth, the universe. I get a sort of feeling like a bubble popping and then nothing.
Oh, Bill replied, blinking. Does he explain why? In a way that you can understand.
I think it's more like something tied to probability, Mimi said, shrugging. I can't make heads or tails of it, really. But he's definite. We have to go along.
Okay, Bill said, shrugging. You're in.
Just like that? Admiral Townsend asked, aghast. The entire team has already been chosen, and they have been training for the last year.
Admiral, whatever Tuffy is, he's never been one to joke around, Bill replied. And if he says that these three have to come along, they have to come along. My recommendation, sir, and I will gladly put it in writing, is that they be assigned as crew.
Okay, I'll get started on the paperwork, the admiral said, looking over at the former chief. There are days, Todd, when I wish you just left me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.